Very good morning to all of you. I hope now the voice is coming. Okay. Hello and good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. My name is Dr. Vijay Bhule. I am from Vetekinol India. I take the opportunity to welcome you all on Vetekinol Virtual Interaction Platform. The name of this program is Veterinary Experts Speaks. Digital initiative designed for sharing the latest technical knowledge and updates related to the veterinary field from expert point of view. I would like to thank all the registered participants who have joined this Zoom webinar and also those participants who are viewing this Zoom webinar on timeline of Vetekinol India Facebook page. Having said that, today's topic of the seminar is Buffalo Mastitis. How it is different than the cattle. Why we have chosen this topic, I would like to tell all the participants. As you are aware that India is largest milk producer in the world, Buffalo contributes around 51% of the total production of the country. We have almost 108 million buffaloes in the country, which is approximately 50% of the total world's buffalo population. Since the goal of the every dairy producer is for production of maximum quality of hygienic milk, but it is practically difficult to achieve this goal as the incidence of the mastitis in dairy animals has been reported high and the causes are of multifactorial in origin. Bovine mastitis remains the most costly and persistent disease of dairy animals in India. And its management is increasing challenge for the dairy producers. Mastitis is highly prevalent and problematic disease affecting the quality and quantity of the milk. Early detection and holistic management approach is bare need of the to combat the mastitis in dairy animals. This webinar is intended to provide the latest information on buffalo mastitis management. Though it is considered as less susceptible than the cattle. According to the expert, this difference might be due to anatomical structure of the mammary gland, length of the dry period, and behavioral pattern in case of the buffaloes. Now, at this virtual platform, let us understand this topic from the expert point of view. I would like to tell you all in short about our today's speaker profile. Our today's speaker, it gives me pleasure to introduce our today's speaker for the program, who is presently working as a scientist in Central Institute of Research in Buffalo, CIRB, which is located in Hisar. Dr. Sarita Yadav is our today's speaker. She is scientist from CIRB Hisar. She did her graduation from College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences Hisar, post-graduation from Indian Veterinary Research Institute, IVRI, Bareilly, and she also completed her Doctor of Philosophy from UAG from the London. After being qualified in ARS NET examination conducted by ICR in 2007, Dr. Sarita joined as in ICR Institute in 2008. She has in total more than 12 years of experience in working in ICR Institute, 8 years CIRB and 4 years with NRCE, National Research Center on Equines. She is also recipient of awards like University Gold Medal, BD Bell Gold Medal. She has also published several research articles National and International Veterinary Journal. This is about Dr. Sarita, who is our today's speaker. Today we have also with us Dr. Ashok Kumar, who is a scientist from CIRB, who has joined today as a co-panelist for today's program. He will also share and contribute his views on buffalo mastitis management. We also like to welcome, Dr. Ashok Kumar to this program. So with this introduction, I welcome our today's speaker, which is lead speaker is Dr. Sarita Yadav and Dr. Ashok Kumar for this program. And I will request them to contribute their views on buffalo mastitis management. So now I would request Dr. Sarita Yadav to deliver her presentation on this particular topic. Over to you, Dr. Sarita. Dr. Sarita, you have to unmute.
Okay. Are you listening to me, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Please, okay. Please start, madam.
Yeah, so I would like to say thank you to Dr. Vijay Mule and his team for inviting me. So the topic of today's discussion is very interesting. That is the buffalo mastitis and how is it different from the cattle mastitis. It is not moving screen.
Is it moving, ma'am? Can you escape and again share?
Yeah, now it has started. Yes, now. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So buffalo is called as the black gold. Why? Because of its significant role in the socio-economic status of the rural India. It provides nutritional livelihood and the employment security to the farmers. Also, it provides higher economic returns to the farmers. Buffaloes, they have better adaptability to the climate. In Haryana, 3/4 of the total milk production comes from the buffaloes, and per day milk availability is 834 grams in Haryana against the national average of 351 grams. Now some of the facts. The livestock sector, it contributes 26% of the agricultural GDP in India, and the buffalo's contribution is more than half of the total milk production, while the cattle, it contributes 45% of the milk production. Asia harbors 97% of the world's buffalo, and India possesses 57% of the world buffalo. Other than the largest milk production or the highest milk production in the world, India is also the largest meat exporter after the Pink Revolution, and 86% contribution is of the buffalo meat. So very interesting fact is the livestock census reflects a negative growth for most of the livestock, but there is a positive growth for the buffaloes. This shows how much the buffalo husbandry is now getting importance among the farmers. There are clear-cut differences in the buffalo milk in compared to the cow's milk. Like buffalo milk has high protein, fat, calcium, phosphorus and energy content. Also, the cholesterol level is quite low in buffalo milk in comparison to the cow milk. In physical characters, flat fat globule size is large, so that we get better dairy products in the buffalo from the buffalo milk, and the phosphatase activity is also less. So the keeping quality of milk is better in buffaloes. Also, the A2 type casein is found in the buffalo milk, and the buffalo milk is known for its flavor because of the fat content. There are some clear-cut differences in the behavior of the buffaloes in comparison to the cattle. Buffaloes, they love bellowing. Why they love bellowing? Because the heat dissipation mechanism of buffalo is poor. The reason being, the skin of the buffalo is black and thick. Secondly, the hair follicles are less. Thirdly, the sweat glands, they are deep-seated. So for the heat dissipation, buffalo needs wallowing in ponds, mud, etc. Also, buffalo love grazing and roaming. This is required for increasing its productivity. Now coming to the Indian buffalo dairy system, there are two buffalo dairy systems prevailing in India. One is the rural and one is the commercial. Rural includes small holding system, like the small and the marginal land farmers, they keep buffaloes. And in the commercial, urban and the peri-urban system, buffalo dairies are there. In the rural system, the semi-intensive system is there, means they are stall fed as well as they are allowed to graze. While in the commercial, urban and the peri-urban, they are typically stall fed only. Here is some of the performance state of the Murrah buffaloes from the different centers of the CIRB, as it is shown in this data. Just a brief discussion, just that if we see the wet average, means the buffaloes in milk are taken, not the dry buffaloes are taken. Average is the 8 kg milk per day, and the herd average where the dry animals are also included, the average is the 5 kg per day. And the lactation length is average 305 days. So now in general, buffaloes are difficult to milk. That is, they are called the hard milkers. The disturbed milk ejection and the termination of the lactation can occur when the calf die or when the milker is replaced. It is not the case in case of the cows. Most farmers, they experience these problems with the buffaloes. And to overcome these problems, the farmers, they give concentrate as a pre-stimulation before the milking to improve the milk letdown. And some farmers, they give oxytocin injections also. In buffaloes, the udder shapes variations are greater in comparison to the cows. Why? Because buffaloes are not selectively bred as the cows. Mother instinct is very high in the buffaloes, so weaning is not done. And the buffalo udder shapes can be classified as the conical, bottle, and the cylindrical shapes, as this is shown in this slide. Now, a brief discussion about the udder structure. As you can see in the slide, there is a gland cisternae and there is a teat cisternae. So now, the cisternal area of the mammary gland can be divided into the teat cisternae and the gland cisternae. In cows, 20 to 40% of the milk remains in the cisternal fractions between the milking. But in buffaloes, 95% of the milk secreted between the milking is stored in the secretory tissues, not in the cisternal fraction. That is, they are also hard milkers. In buffaloes, the cisternal area is smaller in comparison to the cattle. So large proportion of the milk, it remains in the secretory tissues, not excreted. So if we don't empty the udder of the buffalo efficiently during the milking, then there can be a drop in the milk yield. So now coming to the main topic, mastitis. So basically, we all know that what is the mastitis? It's the inflammation of the udder, and the farmers, they report mastitis as the inflamed quarters with the changes in the milk. That is the clinical mastitis. However, the subclinical mastitis is mostly ignored because the no visible external signs are there. Mastitis divided into two categories. Clinical means the swelling, hardness, clots in the milk, watery milk. It can be acute, and the chronic. Chronic means long. It can occur for the long time. While the subclinical and the subclinical, where the no external changes are there. So the clinical mastitis is only just the tip of the iceberg. In a herd, most of the cases will be of the subclinical mastitis, not the clinical mastitis. So that's why subclinical mastitis is so important to diagnose, because it remains in the herd. Now, the prevalence of the mastitis in India, it is 5 to 20% in the buffaloes and higher in the cattle, that is 10 to 50% in the cows. And the subclinical mastitis is 15 to 40 times more prevalent than the clinical mastitis. The effects of the subclinical mastitis decreases the desirable content of the milk, like, and increases the undesirable contents. The plasmin and the lipase enzymes increases. So the plasmin, if increases, the casein will be degraded. So it will affect the mozzarella cheese production. Lipase enzyme will increase, that it will decrease the fat content. We all know that the mastitis causes the financial losses, like the we have to discard the milk, veterinary cost, treatment cost. Indirect causes includes the replacement or the culling of the elite buffaloes, and also the infected buffalo act as a continuous source of the infection for the herd, and it can lead to the permanent udder damage, that is fibrosis also. We all know that the mastitis is associated with the breed, milk yield, stage of the lactation, parity, udder morphology, farm hygiene conditions, climatic conditions, etc. But what is the main difference between the buffalo and the cattle, which makes buffalo more less susceptible to the mastitis in comparison to the cattle? So the answer lies in the teat or teat anatomical structure. So the teat of the buffalo is longer and the thicker in comparison to the cattle. That's why the teat canal is also longer and narrow. So it discourages the entry of the bacteria into the trachea between the milking. Also, there is the circular teeth sphincter muscle around the streak canal is thicker and harder. So it closes the teeth canal tightly. The bacteria can't enter into the streak canal. Also, the streak canal epithelium is thicker. So there is better indigitation of the folds in the streak canal when the sphincter closes. Also, the keratin of the streak canal epithelium, it discourages the bacteria entry, and the lipid layer over the streak canal is bactericidal, so it also prevents bacteria growth. Very interesting factor is, in buffaloes, dry period is nearly 150 days, while in cattle, 45 to 60 days. Means buffaloes, they dry off 3 to 4 months before the calving. So the dry period is very important period for the mastitis prevention. I will explain about the importance of dry period in this slide. That dry period can be divided into the three phases. The first 2 weeks and the last 2 weeks of the dry period are the most crucial, because in the first 2 weeks of the dry period, teeth canal closes and the keratin plug is formed. It prevents the entry of the new infection, while the last 2 weeks the keratin plug dissolves. So this graph shows that during these two periods, most of the infections occur. And in dry period, we have to remove the existing infections, and we have to prevent the new infections from occurring. Otherwise, these infections will flare up as a clinical mastitis in the coming lactation. Buffaloes, they have much higher dry period than the cows. So if subclinical infection is there in the buffalo udder during the dry period, it can damage the udder, cause the fibrosis, and the best time to cure a buffalo is the dry period. We did one study here in at CIRB, and what we found, that the subclinical mastitis during the dry period in buffalo, that prevalence was nearly 84%. 84% of the buffaloes were having the subclinical mastitis, and we gave them dry therapy, and what we found, that after the calving, we got only 27% of the prevalence of mastitis. So it got cured during the dry period by the dry period therapy. This slide shows that there was a champion buffalo. It suffered from the clinical mastitis, could not be cured. We gave it dry therapy and it recovered. Similar to another buffalo, it also recovered by the dry therapy. That's why dry therapy is very important in buffaloes. Coming to the peri-urban and the urban buffalo husbandry practices. So in the peri-urban and the urban buffalo dairies, what we observe, that there is an unhygienic environment around the buffaloes, like dung, urine, mud, and they suffer from the environmental mastitis, contagious mastitis. No clean milk practices are followed. And so the welfare challenge in the urban and the peri-urban region of the are very important to address. In these peri-urban and the urban dairies, the buffaloes suffer from the stunted growth, uncomfortable housing, they are always stall fed, they suffer from the metabolic diseases, skin diseases, and indiscriminate use of injectable antibiotics are there, hormones like the oxytocins were given, overcrowding is there, no wallowing is there, no natural behavior, wallowing or the grazing is done. That's why the buffaloes, they suffer more from the mastitis in these dairies. A brief introduction about the contagious and environmental organisms. Contagious includes Staphylococcus aureus and Streptococcus aegletia and the coagulase negative staphylococci, while the environmental pathogens are E. coli, coliforms, or the Streptococcus uberis. There is a clear-cut difference between the contagious and the environmental mastitis. For the contagious mastitis, the source of infection is the teat and the udder itself. So, and for the environmental mastitis, the contaminated environment around the buffalo, like a dung, soil bedding, is the source. and the transmission in the contagious mastitis occurs during the milking, while in the environmental mastitis it occurs between the milking, that is between the two milking times. And the clinical mastitis cases are more in the environmental mastitis, while the subclinical cases more in the contagious mastitis. Contagious mastitis can be controlled by the, while the environmental mastitis can be controlled by the pre-milking dips. So the both milk dips are important to prevent the mastitis. Though I just told you that the how the teat and the udder anatomy of the buffalo is different from the cattle, this is a general defense mechanism in the teat and the udder against the mastitis. First is the teat skin. As I told you that the teat skin has a keratin layer and the fatty acid layer. They act as a bacteriostatic. They prevent the bacteria attachment, and the pre-dipping teat sanitizers should be used carefully. They should not have high content of detergent, otherwise the fatty acid layer will dissolve and buffalo or animal will become more prone to the mastitis. Also the cuts, cracks, chaps, pox lesions should not be there, otherwise they will make animal more prone to the mastitis. Post-milking, teat dips containing the glycerol emollients should be used to prevent the chapping and all this. And important thing is that the teat stretches 40% more after the, just after the milking. So we have to use the post dips just after the milking to cover all the cracks and the folds. Coming to the teat canal closes 30 minutes after the milking. So we need to make the animal stand for 30 minutes so that the teat sphincter muscles tighten the teat canal and the prevent the entry of the environmental pathogens. During the dry period, teat plug is formed, so the first 2 weeks of the dry period are more susceptible for the new infections to come in. Buffaloes are called the hard milkers because it is more force is required to take the milk out of the cisternae or the teat canal. The slow milk flow is there. So the susceptibility of mastitis is less in buffaloes because they are not that much high yielder as that of the cows. There are some intrinsic other defense mechanisms present like the lactoferrin. Lactoferrin content is very high in the dry period, so the coliform mastitis can be cured during the dry period. The macrophages and the polymorphonuclear cells, they engulf the bacteria and they release the release the hydrogen peroxide, which has to be taken up by the guanidin peroxidase enzyme system. It means the vitamin E and the selenium supplements or the mineral mixture is very important to prevent the oxidative stress in the mastitis. Supplementation of the 1000 international unit of vitamin E per day during the dry period and the 600 international unit per day during the lactation should be encouraged to prevent the mastitis. How a mastitis occurs? As we all know that the environmental mastitis, it comes from the environment, that is soil teats, etc. And the contagious mastitis, it occurs because of the purchase of the infected animal or the presence of the already infected milch animal in the herd. And then the infection is transferred to the teat and. In the contagious mastitis, milkers' hand, udder, clothes, milking machines, they spread the infection, while in the environmental mastitis, infection is spread between the milking. There are two ways to penetrate the teat canal by the bacteria. One is the bacteria multiply and establish a colony at the teat end because of its adhesive factors, and then it takes 3 days to get into the teat canal. For example, the Staphylococcus aureus and the Streptococcus aegyrexia. It is seen in the contagious mastitis. While in the environmental mastitis, the E. coli is involved. No adhesive properties of E. coli are there. So it enters in between the milking, between the two milkings, by the reverse flow of the milk. There are the proven 5 points to reduce the incidence of the mastitis. First, we need to record all the clinical cases. We need to treat all the clinical cases. pre-dipping and the post-dipping should be done. Pre-dipping to prevent the environmental mastitis, post-dipping to prevent the contagious mastitis. Dry animal therapy at the end of the lactation must be done. Culling of the chronic mastitis cases need to be done, or if culling is not done, then the chronic mastitis cases should be milked at the end, and the milking machine should be regularly maintained. Coming to the treatment aspect of the mastitis, mastitis treatment can be done as two therapies. One is the lactation therapy, means when they are in milk, and one is the dry therapy, when animal dried off. I already told the importance of the dry animal therapy. First, the long-acting intramammary preparation is put in the dry period, and it eliminates the existing infection, and it prevents the occurrence of the new intramammary infections, and decreases the clinical mastitis and the subclinical mastitis in the subsequent lactation. And also it reduces the it decreases the any drop in the milk production, reproductive performance decline. So the two main routes for the mastitis treatment are intramammary treatment and the parenteral treatment. Now there is a debate that the self-cure is better than the giving the antibiotics. So many clinical trials have been done, and it is found that the antibiotic cure is better than the spontaneous cure. What are the benefits of the antibiotic therapy? It provides higher bacteriological elimination than the self-cure, and it reduces the chronic recurrent infections, and it also reduces milk yield depression, and somatic cell count comes to an acceptable limit, that is 150,000 per ml of the milk, or 1.5 lakhs per ml of the milk is the somatic cell count desirable. Now, intramammary or systemic administration of the antibiotic, which route we should follow? The target site, it depends on the causative agent. For example, the streptococci, they mostly remain in the milk compartments, and the Staphylococcus aureus, it penetrates the udder tissue, form a fibrous tissue around, and causes a deep infection, fibrosis, abscesses. So the most common route of administration in mastitis is intramammary route. The advantage of this route is that the high concentration of the substance of the antibiotic can be achieved in the milk or the udder, and it can directly act on the bacteria. But theoretically, it is said that the systemic route is more efficient, but it is quite difficult to maintain the therapeutic concentration in the milk by the systemic route. So, which route which we should follow to control the mastitis? It depends on the type of the pathogen infecting. Like if the streptococcus infection is there, which mostly reside in the milk and the milk ducts, so we should go for the intramammary route. And for the Staphylococcus aureus, it remains deep seated in the udder tissue, intramammary route is good. For the coliforms, parenteral route is good. But it is said that the combination therapy is the best to treat mastitis. That is, we should give intramammary route as well as parenteral administration simultaneously, both together, to completely cure the mastitis. Secondly, extended therapy should be used. It means that drug should not be used only for the 3 days like that. It should be used at least for the 5 to 8 days, extended therapy to have a complete bacteriological cure. And if antibiotic treatment is used for a short duration, then relapse will occur. It will cause a poor cure rate. So the extended therapy should be used. Secondly, one very important factor is that we should use the long acting antibiotics. Why? Because the repeated intramuscular injections of very large volume of the antibiotics can cause irritation and is not for the good for the animal welfare. So a one shot long acting antibiotic is very effective for the mastitis control, provided a combination therapy should be given, like the intramammary as well as parental both. There are some infectious diseases of udder which make animal more susceptible to mastitis, and we should differentiate these infections from mastitis, like the bacterial eczema, where there occurs sore teeth at one side only, and it is caused by the anaerobic bacteria, Fusobacterium, and it gives good response to the injectable antibiotics, parental as well as the topical teat ointments. Second is the bovine herpes mammalitis. It is a viral disease. Once it occurs, it gives lifelong immunity, and it causes necrotic dermatitis, blackening like on the skin, and it is a very painful condition. So symptomatic treatment has to be done, like using the emollient tips, glycerol, pain relieving medicines, pre-dipping with the glycerin. Next is the pseudocowpox. It is viral disease of the teeth, skin, and the characteristic shoe-shaped lesions are formed. They are not painful, and the immunity is short-lived. It may occur after 7 to 8 months. Next is the buffalo pox, and another disease is the teat warts caused by the papilloma virus. So these are the basic discussion done. In summary, buffalo mastitis. Buffaloes are prone to mastitis, but in comparison to the cattle, they are less susceptible to the mastitis because of some anatomical differences in their teat and the udder. Some inherited difference, inherited differences. That means the selective breeding is not done as that in the crossbred and the exotic cattle for the milk production. So they are naturally resistant in comparison to the exotic ones. Also, the cisterna of the udder and the in buffaloes is relatively smaller than the cattle, so they are hard milkers. So I would like to say thank you to Dr. Vijay Mule and his team for inviting me. Thank you. So the session is open for the questions.
Yes. Thank you, madam. Now I think we'll take some of the questions. I think we have received more than 30 questions as of now, and the questions are coming. Madam, thank you so much for this elaborative speech on the topic buffalo mastitis, how it is different than the cattle. Okay, and really there are certain interesting facts that need to be understood, that how the anatomical structure, how the behavioral pattern, and the length of the dry period, that makes a difference in buffalo. They are less prone comparatively than the cattle. So with this, I think we'll take some of the questions, okay? And I hope that, madam, we can share this PowerPoint PDF form once the presentation and our webinar is over. So we can share it to the participants. There are requests coming in the message that they would like to get the PowerPoint. Madam, and I would request Dr. Ashok Kumar also to share his views. Okay, Dr. Ashok Kumar, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay.
Can you stop the screen sharing so that we can see you and Dr. Ashok to the participant?
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay.
Thanks
to your team also. Questions. One doc sir was asking about the doka. It's buffalo are showing the silent stress nowadays. and the doka is very important sign for the showing the stress and pre-stress during pre-stress. So we can say like that ki it's the temporary teeth engorgement before and after breaking during the period of pre-stress stage and stress stage. And generally up to 3 days after showing the doka sign, animal come in the heat. And another doka is gov doka. It comes after 2 weeks of the insemination. Farmers generally recognize ki now animal is pregnant. And most of the time, up to 75% to 80%, it's confirmatory as per their experience. Although one study is going on at our institute for the larger data collection like that. And another thing is that during this doka, 8% milk loss is observed by the farmers, and during gov doka, 5% milk loss is there. So generally some farmers and it depends on the buffalo to buffalo. If animal is showing doka, it means ki chances are there up to 90% animal is in heat or animal is cyclic. So it's directly related to that, and farmer consider ki complete let down of milking is not there. After milking also this temporary teat engorgement is there. And another question was there relationship of metritis and mastitis. As we all veterinarian know ki when the mastitis will be there, mastitis chances will be there. And one doctor was telling ki that no milk is there. If severe in case of severe mastitis in buffalo, we have observed direct association between metritis and mastitis, as well as no letdown of the milk also. It's directly related to each other. So we cannot ignore metritis. Metritis may be due to the brucellosis. Metritis may be due to other microorganism. So we all know ki by our experience ki it's directly related. And another doctor was asking about the dry period therapy in buffaloes. Dry period therapy is very effective for the high yielder buffaloes. For the if the lactation numbers are higher, like 6th, 5th, and as doctor has mentioned, if few buffaloes, champion buffaloes in there, they are producing very good milk in their 6th, 7th lactation. These farmers are managing their buffalo after 4th lactation with the dry period therapy. And if the animal is having history of clinical mastitis, if animal is having subclinical mastitis with the bacterial isolation, then definitely farmer should treat the buffalo before drying off, as well as go for the dry period therapy if he has availability of the intramammary antibiotics. So we can say that we don't require blanket therapy for any, no need to treat each and every buffalo for the dry period therapy. It's not required at all. And another question I was
preparation of dry therapy,
which
means the preparation
any available safety for long term intramammary safety for preparation is no, I think only limited intramammary preparation are available, and intramammary ceftiofur is available, and another brand is also available. I don't know. Yes, doctor.
Yes, 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 sir.
So limited intramammary option dry period. The product is available.
Long-acting antibiotic
usage is very much useful for giving the intramammary therapy. But the farmers, like most of the time, they use the antibiotic by themselves, and due to mishandling or due to pain in the udder, so every time it will not allow to touch the teeth for the intramammary therapy. If there will be long-acting intramammary intramammary preparation is available, then it will be good to give a single intramammary tube like that.
Is there an example of long-acting antibiotic?
Here are the questions.
Okay, there are certain questions which are
mastitis and teeth. Yes, yes. mastitis and teat blockage. One doctor is asking about that, Dr. Reddy. As doctor has mentioned, that streptococcus infection, sometimes it adds the teat end, and sometimes it makes the pencil formation kind of hardening in the teat. So severe cases it leads to blockage also. So isolation of bacteria is very much important, and it's directly related with that such kind of changes in the teat end quarter. So and for that intramammary prevention is very much required, and without that we cannot treat.
Okay, sir, there are certain questions which has came to us also. Can we answer that questions also? I'll ask some of the questions. Yeah. Dr. Ashok?
Just a minute. One, Dr. Saab is asking about the cause of DOCA in buffalo. It's the typical differential sign for the buffalo, for the estrus, we can say. And if you will ask from the farmers, it's some animals, means some buffalo lines, they are showing high DOCA sign and some are less. But most of the buffaloes are showing DOCA signs. It's their behavior.
Correct.
Can we
take some of the questions which has came?
Yes, please.
I think as of now there are 80-81 questions are there. Maybe we're not able to take all the questions, but some of the interesting questions which we received, we can take it. And yes, other questions, I hope that Dr. Ashok and Dr. Sarita can mail it to the participant. The first question is that according to the behavioral pattern, buffaloes are considered as water or mud loving animals and are comfortable to survive in unhygienic environment. Is that a particular reason that buffalo are naturally resistant to mastitis and less susceptible to mastitis than cattle?
You
understand? Yes, Dr. Sarita. Yeah. Or Dr. Ashok.
Dr. Saab, we cannot say ki it's that, as Dr. Sarita has mentioned, for this heat dissipation, it's very much essential to keep that buffaloes with the wallowing facility like that. And if high yielding animal will be in the muddy environment with dung, urine, then chances of mastitis will be there. It's not like that ki it's foolproof ki no mastitis will be there. Although low producing animals are giving 2 kg, 3 kg and 4 kg. If you will see in this remote tribal areas where the animal are roaming and giving only 2 kg milk. So mastitis cases are less in those cases. Quarter losses are less in those cases. And if dairy animal we are talking about, if we will allow them 10 kg and 12 kg animal, so definitely the mastitis will be there. So it's directly related to the production. So otherwise, animal is very much resistant to mastitis in comparison to exotic cattle.
And also, the breeding is not much done in the buffaloes as compared to the crossbred cows for the milk production. So maybe some inherent.
Yes, very diverse group. Diverse yes. group of.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, madam. In your presentation, you said that the epithelium of the streak canal is thicker and compact in buffalo than the cattle.
Yes.
The epithelium of the streak canal is thicker and compact in buffaloes than the cattle. Mm. Is that a particular region that bacterial entry and the invasion and multiplication in buffalo teat is comparatively less than the cattle?
Yes. Yes. There may be a reason. This may be a reason. The teat. Canal epithelium is made of the stratified squamous epithelium. That is, it has a keratin layer plus there is fatty acid layer. So this keratin layer, it discourages the bacteria attachment, and also the fatty acid layer, it inhibits the bacteria. So it is thicker in buffalo. So the interdigitation of the folds of this epithelia are more efficient in buffaloes in comparison to the cows once that circular teat sphincter closes. So maybe this reason that the bacteria doesn't enter into the teat canal.
Okay. So definitely
and make it less susceptible to mastitis.
Yeah, definitely anatomical structure of the mammary gland makes difference on the susceptibility of the mastitis. Being the expert from the CIRB, what is your observation? Which is the major challenge in buffalo, clinical or subclinical?
Subclinical, definitely subclinical mastitis is a major challenge. We did at CIRB and we found that the 83% of prevalence of this subclinical mastitis in buffaloes. Definitely, subclinical mastitis is a bigger challenge.
At the time of crying.
Actually, yes. It is mostly ignored.
At the time of crying.
Yes.
At the time of crying.
Yes.
Especially in the urban and peri-urban dairies.
Okay. Urban and peri-urban dairies. So you mean to say that animal welfare also plays important role on susceptibility to the
definitely oral health as well as the udder health.
Correct. How does this length of the dry period in buffaloes make difference in susceptibility of clinical mastitis in buffaloes after calving?
You said that
there is a self-cure mechanism in buffalo, which is interesting fact that is not there in case of the cattle. Okay, so that's why dry cow infections are more prominent.
Yes, the dry period in buffalo is longer than the cows. That means on an average it is 150 days, while in the cows it is 45 to 60 days. So we found that the subclinical mastitis cases during the dry period are very high in the buffaloes. Nearly, we found 83% cases. So if subclinical mastitis is there during the dry period, the persisting infection may destroy the alveoli of the udder, cause the fibrosis during that period, because the buffalo dries 3 to 4 months before calving. There is a long period gap. So if we inject the dry therapy, lot of time is there to for the udder to heal itself from the infection, and so in the subsequent lactation, clinical mastitis will not flare up. So a long dry period in buffalo is a positive.
So in India, it is observed that especially milking method, hand milking is mostly preferred in buffalo. Is this a major reason for development of the contagious pathogens in the buffaloes? And does pre and post dipping is recommended in mastitis management approach in buffalo?
Yes, definitely. In buffaloes, hand milking is preferred, not the machine milking. Various reasons are there. First, the buffaloes are mostly reared by the rural farmers, and they have 3 to 4 buffaloes, so they can't afford these milking machines. Milking machines are used in the dairy farms. Secondly, the buffaloes are hard milkers, means the a lot of force is required to eject the milk of the teat canal. So if we will use the machine, milking machines, so there may be injury to the teat, and it is said, and there may be the like that. So milking machine is not much preferred in the buffaloes, but nowadays
by the farmers,
but the dairy farmers, they have started using this. And definitely the hand milking is a major source of the contagious mastitis, because if one animal is infected with the subclinical mastitis, it can spread to the healthy animal through the milker's hand during the hand milking. And the also the hand milking methods the farmers use mostly are the knuckling method, which damages the teat canal. We should use the full fist method to eject the for the milking, so that the teat canal is not damaged like that. Yes.
Okay. So in field conditions, veterinarians nowadays are preferring long acting therapy for mastitis treatment, like cefoparazone, intramammary, ceftazoxime sodium like preparation. This provides more convenience and compliance for treatment approach.
So, definitely, yes.
Expert of CIRB, what is your views on that?
Yes, long acting antibiotics should be used, because the farmers, they usually don't give extended therapy, they give just for 1 or 2 days. It doesn't give complete bacteriological cure. For the complete bacteriological cure, at least 6 to 8 days course should be given, which is not feasible. That's why the long acting shots should be given. That one shot, it will prevent the irritation at the site. Also, it is good for the animal welfare, and thirdly, it is convenient for the farmers. Okay. And it completely cured the.
And antibody resistance species will be there definitely.
And together with the intramammary route also, both routes used for the complete.
Okay. Cure. So there are certain reports in urban and semi-urban area that there are like wart-like lesions are present on the teat surface, which is normally considered as a telitis first, and these further develop ulcerative mastitis, which is very difficult to treat, and this happens in urban and semi-urban area in case of the buffalo. So what is your views on this?
Yeah, yes, actually in the peri-urban areas, because it may be because of the contagious organisms, like it may be the pseudocowpox or maybe the herpes infection, and it transmitted from one infected animal to the healthy through the milker's hand, or so that the warts problem. Maybe
there. This is the papillomavirus. And that pox, as Dr. Sabi is suggesting.
Buffalo pox is zoonotic, yes.
Buffalo pox is zoonotic in Maharashtra, it's very common.
It's very common in the Maharashtra state.
Okay.
For such kind of cases, I think overall health of the animal is very much important, as well as the milkers who are milking those animals, they should take all precautions.
My last question will be, being you both are working as a scientist in CIRB, which is a very reputed institute in not only in India, in Asia, a very premium institute of ICR, CIRB. So how CIRB can help field veterinarians to get latest update on health management of buffalo? Do you have any short duration training programs available at your institute?
Dr. Saab, our institute is fully dedicated for buffaloes. In Asia is the single institute, and now recently some institute, Carabao research centers, they have also come, but for the ASEAN countries, for the SAARC countries, for this BRAC countries, and for this animal husbandry department officials, we are conducting annually 2-3 programs for the updation of their knowledge, and that refresher courses like that, and it will be sponsored by the Department of Agriculture, Government of India,
and calendar is available on the website.
So if anyone is interested, every time our institute as well as the Department of Agriculture, they send the letter to the development agencies like animal husbandry department for this training, and they sponsor, it's the free of cost for them, like that.
Yes, okay. And the training calendar is available at the site.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Sarita, Dr. Ashok, for this elaborative presentation on the topic, and definitely there are many questions, but because of the time constraint, we would not be able to take all the questions. So what we'll do, that we'll send these questions to you that on email, and then you can answer that and send it to us. So we'll compile and send it to all the participants who are there in the join this program. Also, we'd like to request you that, can you share your presentations? We'll make a PDF of that presentation and share it to all the participants. Once again, thank you, Dr. Sarita, Dr. Ashok, and all the participants. Now, I would request Mr. Das, Mr. Anjan Kumar Das, to present the vote of the thanks. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay, and namaste, good afternoon all. So in behalf of Edoquinol, I thank you, Dr. Sarita Yadav and Dr. Ashok Kumar, speaker of the day, who has given a very, very presentation on the buffalo mastitis, how it is different than the cattle. Really, it is very interesting and informative presentation. How can say that, you see, the more than 100 questions we have received, it clearly shows that the presentation was very interesting and informative. And our sincere thanks to all the participants, those who have taken out their valuable time on Sunday and the participate in this webinar. Due to the, as Dr. Vijay has rightly mentioned, due to the time limitations, we could not able to answer all the questions. But however, we have noted down all your questions, and we will definitely respond you back, maybe through your mail or we will respond you back through mail. And thank you once again for your participation, and My sincere thanks to our sales and marketing team for their support and contribution for this webinar. And once again, thank you all and stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.